It all began as a 10-week chase to the championship. 12 drivers, 10 races to prove their worth, just one trophy. It's now time to turn it up a notch. Halfway to the end game, the NASCAR Sprint Cup Series heads to the biggest, the fastest, and arguably most unpredictable track on the schedule, Talladega Super Speedway. In years past, this has been where championships turn on a dime, where once sure things turn into long shots, and lucky breaks and near misses become clinchers. Today, not only will a driver need a bit of luck, he'll also need a teammate. Because just like no one person can win a championship, no one driver can win this race. Not if he tries going it alone.
Getting set to go with 500 miles at the Talladega Super Speedway. A look at the starting lineup coming across the top of your screen. Field headed by Mark Martin, two-time winner here, his 51st career pole. Mark going to lead this field to the green flag. Up momentarily with the five-time consecutive champ, Jimmy Johnson, alongside. Now, the man that's going to be paired with Johnson in the draft, or at least that's the plan for most of the day, is starting in row three. He's our in-race reporter, Dale Earnhardt Jr., and the subject of our Gillette Pro Glide profile. Junior's first few years in the NASCAR Sprint Cup Series, he was almost unbeatable here. Recently, not so much, but remember, he was the one that pushed Johnson to the win in April. Skeptic or believer about today in a junior win?
I'm a little skeptical if he's going to be the pusher.
He's going to be the one pushing Jimmy
Johnson.
Yeah,
I'm skeptical he can get to the checker flag first.
All right, well, Junior rolling off on the pace laps, as you can see, and let's talk to our in-race reporter.
Hey, Junior, Dale Jarrett, ESPN, you have a copy?
Sure do.
Hey, man, our first question is mailbag, and it comes from Jim in York, Pennsylvania. He asked, when you're the second car in a drafting pair, how much firmer are you gripping the wheel, and how much more tense are you than normal?
Well, you're pretty tense. You can't really see the spoilers on the car as wide as they've ever been or about as tall as they've ever been. So you just kind of hoping the guy you're pushing is telling you what's happening and where he's going so you can kind of be ready. But it's a lot harder, actually, you know, pushing than it is being out front.
All right, let's switch roles there. Talk about the guy in front, which I know you would like to be. But who makes that decision when you're paired up, when it gets time to win this race at the end? Who decides who's going to be in front and who's going to be pushing?
Well, between me and Jimmy, we just talked it out and decided what was the most productive package in that particular race. And, you know, we make that choice and go with it. You know, you got to... Unfortunately, you got to make a lot of sacrifices when you're working with somebody all day long. The way this package works and the way you got to work together, you make a lot of sacrifices, and somebody's got to. If you're trying to win a race, someone, one of you's got to run second or whatever. So that's just the way it is.
Take Jeff Gordon long to find Mark Martin's back bumper.
It's almost like he rooted that 33 car Bowyer out of the way so he could get with his partner, but here comes Bowyer up on the outside.
Yeah, you can see Bowyer stayed in the throttle, and Mark Martin slowing up to get with Gordon there. Slowed him down, but that's not going to take long to remedy that situation.
Outside, Jimmy Johnson pushed by Dale Earnhardt Jr. to the point as they come down to complete lap one. That yellow car, Kurt Busch, is waiting for the black machine in the outside lane, the 78 of Regan Smith. That's his planned drafting partner.
And why do they have to have a drafting partner? If you're not teamed up, if you're not paired up with another car, you're going to be running anywhere from 8 to 12 miles an hour slower than what these cars are running together.
And we talk about paired up, we mean physically touching. They have to be mechanically linked up to be able to make this work and to make it work like it really needs to make that kind of speed.
Ryan Newman, 39, with Tony Stewart, his team owner and teammate, to the top spot now. And here come David Reagan in the 6 and Matt Kenseth in the 17 running to the outside.
Yeah, saw this work at Daytona back in July. Matt Kenseth pushed David Reagan to his first Sprint Cup victory there.
Reagan leads that lap in the last three races at Talladega. 88, 87, and 88 official lead changes at the start-finish line in a 188-lap race each time.
Yeah, no reason to think that there's going to be anything different today. I think they know more about this type drafting that is going to make it even more exciting throughout the day.
Well, they're on pace for 188 lead changes. two lead changes.
Yeah. Kevin Harvick.
See, Kurt Busch has gotten paired up with Regan Smith up on the high side. They're coming in a hurry.
Yeah, now, it's not going to be the first time today I'm going to call Clint Bowyer, Kevin Harvick, because their cars have somewhat of a similar paint scheme today. Bowyer pushing Jeff Burton in the 31, and there's Kenseth to the lead. Leads a lap. That is one bonus point toward the championship for Matt Kenseth. Remember, if you lead a lap or lead the most laps, you get a point. And a point in this NASCAR system is big.
But in doing that, look how quickly it slows them down and these other cars catch them and surpass.
Jeff Burton, 31, to the point.
See Denny Hamlin now linking up with Trevor Bayne in the 21.
Back live, Talladega. We are under green. An attempt to get to pit road for a green flag stop. We talked about it going to the break. It went wrong for Joey Logano and Kyle Busch because there was some other traffic slowing through the pack ahead of them. Kind of a complex situation. Bottom line, Logano's off the pace. Kyle Busch lost his wingman, and we're still under green. Trevor Bayne and Robbie Gordon had gotten separated on the racetrack. So watch Bayne in the red and white 21.
Yeah, he's motioning. He's coming to the pit. Woo! Logano didn't get slowed down. Look at this save. I mean, this car is sideways. So from that point, he didn't go to pit road. Kyle Busch went all the way down pit road without stopping.
Oh,
now the tire comes apart.
Caution will come out now.
On pit road, while the green is still out, Vince.
The 48 and the 88 pitting together. Chassis adjustment on the 48, four tires. The 88 says he's got a little bit of a vibration as well, so they're working just hoping that it's a tire issue for the 88. No chassis adjustment on Dale Earnhardt Jr.
Jeff Gordon in, a little bit of wedge out of the left rear, trying to free the back of the car, a little bit under the pushing four tires, getting it full of fuel. Gordon down and away, guys.
And look who's coming on the outside.
Yep, just as we suspected what might happen. Here's Denny Hamlin's hooked onto the back bumper. Kyle Busch going places in a hurry, Vince.
Well, and that's certainly been looking for a partner, Denny Hamlin, and he found one with Kyle Busch. Kyle and Denny are working with Denny's spotter, Curtis Markham. We've got a crash, guys.
Ryan Newman spinning off the tri-oval. Caution flag. Got some damage on the left front of that car. You see that front splitter all wrinkled up.
Yeah, the whole front end's tore off of.
Looks like he may have gotten off in the trial of the grass. The lower half of the front end's gone.
And if he drives
that right front run, it's all the way down.
Yeah, where I was going with that. If he drives that back around the racetrack too quickly, his right front fender is going to end up looking like Joey Logano's.
Now, he's got a lot of problems anyway, though. You can see right there in the trial of the grass.
That's just the air literally sucking that car around as he got up beside of David Ruderman. When you're that close,
hard to tell from that angle if that double zero was coming down at all.
Well, it just wasn't enough room there. And when you get this close to these cars,
no.
You can see, well, it's just that there's a lane there, that bottom lane, there's a little bit of a where the pavement goes together and where the lanes were. It's a little uneven right there. And Ryan came up there with Tony pushing him, and it's just the uneasiness that you get going through the tri-oval and then another car taking the air off of it. It sent Ryan Newman spinning.
Yeah, I think one of the things working against
trouble. Allmendinger turned around. Kyle Busch makes contact. More cars involved. Harvick is in it, one of the championship drivers.
Lock it down there, AJ. Get it rolling here if you can.
McMurray involved. Kyle Busch, Kevin Harvick, second in the championship, starting the day. Front end damage to that 29 car.
Got a lot of damage to Kyle Busch too. You can see that right front looks like it's headed the wrong way, like it might have a toe-in issue.
And that looked like maybe a push that the 43 of A.J. Allmendinger got through the tri-oval, which is probably the most dangerous part of this racetrack.
Juan Pablo Montoya collected.
Yeah, so is McMurray. This is a strong pairing right here. Get knocked out.
Yeah, and it was Allmendinger being pushed by his teammate, Marcos Ambrose, in the nine. I agree with you, DJ. That looked like that's where that started.
Yeah, and the cars get light there already.
The tires are straight.
You're getting a push, and that's what creates these situations in the tri-oval, because the tri-oval may look rather subtle, but it's a pretty good turn inside the race car.
Watch the top there, the outside, 43 and 9.
Yeah, it was just a big run that they had. They were going extremely fast, but it's just literally the rear wheels start getting picked up, and then that turns you down the racetrack and into the other cars.
It goes back to the thing that the guy behind cannot see. And so Allmendinger was trying, looked like he tried to check up a little bit because there wasn't quite enough room on the outside. And Ambrose just couldn't see that.
Yeah, he was probably having to check up just a little bit to keep from running over Joey Logano and Tony Stewart right in front of him. But Marcos Ambrose having no idea, and it just takes a split second of cracking the throttle.
So Kyle Busch, fourth in the championship. Kevin Harvick, second in the championship, starting the day. And watch Matt Kenseth in that 17 slide through. Just barely.
And a good thing there was David Ragan gave Matt Kenseth room to do what he needed. He saw it, even though he was the car behind, he was able to get back, give Matt room, and not run over and push Matt into the rest of the pile.
Yeah, that's great reactions for Ragan. You see him just pull right back off the back bumper.
And how close Kenseth came to scraping the wall with the right side of that car. From Kevin Harvick.
Yeah, Kevin just a victim of this. He was just sitting down there minding his own business.
Spin. We're in it. It's all beat up.
No way for him to avoid that. You know, one thing that's happening here is it's too early in this race to know who really has what. I think when you see these, you know, the race start closing to the finish, you're going to see people at the front that we haven't seen all day long, and you're going to see who has the best car. So just because they can hold off some cars now doesn't mean they'll hold off some later.
Yeah, because as we talked earlier, they're not going to be as offset trying to get air to that radiator and keep them cooler. They're going to be tucked in as tight as they possibly can and pushing as much as they possibly can to make as much speed.